Last week, I went to Best Buy, and I noticed this TP-Link Wi-Fi 7 router on the shelf listed for $1,500. This was absolutely insane to me, so I snapped a picture of it, I posted it on Twitter, and then it absolutely blew up. People were shocked at the price, and there were a ton of comments about how Wi-Fi 7 isn't even a set standard yet, and no one should be buying that device. The router in question was the TP-Link Archer BE19000 Tri-Band Wi-Fi 7 router. Besides Wi-Fi 7 capability, it features dual 10 gigabit Ethernet ports, a 10 gigabit fiber port, and four 2.5 gigabit ports for LAN connectivity. Now, those are some pretty decent specs, but pricing it at $1,500 is still totally insane. However, it turns out I was wrong about that. Eagle-eyed Twitter users noticed that the product on the price label was different from the product on the shelf. The $1,500 was actually for the TP-Link Deco BE22000 Whole Home Mesh 3-Pack. And the product on the shelf is actually only $599 MSRP, not $1,500. But that doesn't change the fact that $599 for an all-eggs-in-one-basket TP-Link router is still a pretty outrageous price, and $1,500 for the TP-Link Deco Whole Home Mesh System is just a great way for those who have more money than sense to prove how quickly they can throw their money right down the toilet. Especially when the Wi-Fi 6E version of that same product is at Costco for $269. So then what kind of home network would I build for $600? And what would I build for $1,500? We're gonna dig into that in this video, and we're also gonna talk about why Wi-Fi 7 in late 2023 is mostly marketing bull. Let's do this. Something is wrong with your home network and you need it fixed ASAP. You've got a Netgear firewall, a TP-Link switch, and a Unify access point. Which of those vendors are you gonna call for tech support? Do those vendors even provide quality tech support for their products? What if one vendor tells you to call the other vendor? How much do you value your time? If you want a one-stop shop to fix or enhance your home or small business network, then look no further than Rogue Support. With Rogue Support, it's easy. You just open up a ticket, and then qualified technicians handpicked by me will bid on the job and work to get your network running smoothly on your schedule. And you aren't charged a dime until your ticket has been resolved. You can find Rogue Support on the web at rogue.support. Give us a chance the next time your network needs some love and you won't be disappointed. Let's start by talking a bit about Wi-Fi 7 and where it stands here at the end of 2023. The Wi-Fi Alliance has not yet certified the Wi-Fi 7 standard, which is also known as 802.11be. It's getting pretty close though, with certification of the standard expected to happen in early 2024. Personally though, I wouldn't invest into any product touting Wi-Fi 7 today. Not until the standard has been formalized and chipsets are being released that conform to that standard. Official Wi-Fi 7 certification doesn't even exist yet, though the Wi-Fi Alliance does state that any commercial devices with 802.11be should be referred to as containing Wi-Fi 7 technology until certification is available. Now, it's fully possible that TP-Link and other vendors who are already selling Wi-Fi 7 devices will be fully compliant with the standard once it's formalized, but that's not a 100% guarantee. Not to mention that even if your access points are capable of Wi-Fi 7, there aren't any devices on the market that support it yet. If you search Amazon for Wi-Fi 7, I could only find a single Intel Wi-Fi 7 BE2000 network card that's available in an M.2 format for laptops. Heck, even Wi-Fi 6E network cards aren't all that common. I mean, most of the devices on the market today are Wi-Fi 6. Over the next year, we're going to see more and more devices coming out that support Wi-Fi 7, such as the Google Pixel 8, which is available today. But when there are devices out there that support Wi-Fi 7, home users still may not even notice any difference between Wi-Fi 6 and Wi-Fi 7 because the improvements in Wi-Fi 7 standard have to do with device density. Wi-Fi 7 is going to allow more devices to communicate faster and with more bandwidth at the same time. If you're at home with a couple dozen wireless devices, Wi-Fi 6 is more than sufficient for your needs. I mean, you are not a sports arena. So why then is TP-Link selling Wi-Fi 7 routers today? It's all marketing, right? They just want to be the first vendor on the market featuring Wi-Fi 7. It's very similar to how Xfinity has thrown a ton of marketing dollars into promoting Xfinity 10G. Like, 10G? Like, what the heck is that? It's vaporware. It's marketing. There's no such thing as 10G technology in wireless. Some marketing guy just came up with it. You know, everyone out there is advertising 5G. We should start advertising 10G. It's twice as good as 5G. Yeah, but 10G isn't a thing. That doesn't matter. People are gonna think it's great, right? So while TP-Link's marketing isn't the same level of blatant misinformation as Xfinity's 10G, it's still mostly just marketing. Maybe 2025, we'll see some wider adoption after the standard has been certified. So then what kind of network would I build for $600 or for $1,500? All right, let's start with the $600 network. Anyone who's a fan of this channel knows that I'm a big fan of UniFi devices, and you can build an awesome UniFi network with a $600 budget. As an added bonus, you can separate out your access points to provide better coverage than you're able to achieve with a single device in a single location. All right, so let's use an example floor plan. Here is a very large house, about 3,400 square feet, which is about 315 square meters. If you drop the $600 TP-Link Archer BE19000 into this home, let's say the internet terminates into this front study, your wireless coverage from that one device may not cover the entire house. So notice here, we've got the Wi-Fi terminated in the front study. You can see this back bedroom over here isn't getting great coverage because of the amount of walls that that Wi-Fi has to travel through. This is 5 gigahertz that I'm showing, by the way. And parts of the garage, you know, this bedroom over here, it's just not great, right? When you have internet terminated to a specific location in the house, you're kind of stuck there if you have an all-in-one device that has your wireless access point included. Now, let's look at a $600 UniFi network. For this network, I started with the Dream Router, which is Wi-Fi 6 and not Wi-Fi 7, but we've already established that Wi-Fi 7 isn't really realistic for home users. So the Dream Router is $199 when it's in stock. It has a Wi-Fi 6 access point, a 4-port gigabit switch, and two of those ports are power over Ethernet ports. And then it also has a gigabit WAN port. This should be a pretty ideal UniFi console for most home users, unless you have an internet connection that's greater than 1 gigabit. In that case, you're gonna have to spend a little bit more money on your gateway device. Adding to the Dream Router, I have included the USW Lite 8 PoE. This is a small 8-port switch with 4 PoE ports, and it's going to extend the available wired connections in your network. I'll add, though, that this switch is actually totally optional in this setup. If you're only adding in the two access points that we're about to talk about, those can be powered directly by the Dream Router. But by having this switch in your network, you'll have a total of 12 Ethernet ports, 6 of which can supply power to devices using PoE. For the access points, I went with the U6 Plus. Now, these are just a step above the U6 Lite access points, and since you'll end up with 3 total access points in your network, you can spread them around the house for much better coverage than you would get with a single access point at the front of the house. Let's take a look at this design in the UniFi Design Center. All right, so here you can see our single access point at the front of the house. This is, for instance, if you had that TP-Link device, it's not gonna provide full coverage to everywhere that you want it. Now, if we switch to our $600 network, though, look what happens, okay? When you have 3 access points and you're able to spread those out in different areas of your house, they're all broadcasting from those areas, right? So you can even move these around. I put them kind of in the hallway over here and the hallway over here. It's gonna cover these bedrooms really well, and you're gonna get full coverage for everywhere else. The only place in here that looks like it's not quite covered perfectly is the garage, but you should still pretty much be okay if you're working out there. So you've got your Dream Router up front along with that 8-port PoE switch and 2 extra access points. You're all set. You've got a really nice network. The total for all of this equipment comes to $566, which leaves $44 left over for other stuff. Now, you may need the extra money to run Ethernet around the house if you don't have Ethernet pre-installed, or you may want to tack on something like the Flex Mini Switch to expand wired connectivity behind your entertainment center, or better yet, put that $44 towards a good UPS for your equipment. But whatever you do, the point here is that this setup will provide much better overall wireless coverage for your home. You also have the option of expanding this network even further if you want to. So for example, if the coverage in the backyard or the garage isn't as good as you want, you can keep adding on to this network for even better Wi-Fi. I do also want to point out the disadvantages of this kind of network. I mean, first off, you will have to run Ethernet around the house, which can be a pain if it's not pre-wired. So now you're drilling holes in the walls and you're terminating cables, you're crawling through the attic or the crawl space. It's not the most fun thing. It's not going to be as easy as a single device like that TP-Link router that's mostly plug and play. There's more of a learning curve to the setup of Unified Network, but that's why YouTube exists, right? You can watch my videos and I'll tell you exactly how to do all this stuff. Future Chris popping in here real quick as I am editing this video, and please pay no mind to what's going on over here. We're going to get to that $1,500 network in just a moment, but two quick things that I wanted to let you know about. First is that I have created a blog post to go along with this video in case you wanted to take a closer look at these network diagrams. Link is down in the description. Second is that after I recorded this video, I found even more ridiculously priced Wi-Fi products like the TP-Link BE33000 coming in at $1,800. And the Netgear Orbi Wi-Fi 7 mesh system that is available for a whopping $2,300. Now, I'm not going to design out even more networks for all these additional price points, but I did just want to reiterate that the whole point of this video is that you don't have to spend this kind of money to have excellent Wi-Fi in your home. Save your money and spend it on something actually useful. Okay, let's get back to our $1,500 Unify network. In this case, we're comparing a Unify system to a whole home mesh wireless system. So coverage-wise, you know, wireless coverage-wise, they're pretty much going to be about the same. The $1,500 TP-Link whole home mesh gets you 3 mesh nodes, and that's it. It's going to be a lot easier to set up, and all you got to do is, you know, plug those wireless nodes into power, and they mesh together wirelessly. But you could also hardwire them if you wanted to run Ethernet around the house. The benefit that you get by going with a Unify system is flexibility. You can add in more wired ports by adding in switches, right? You can add additional access points to your backyard or your garage if you need better coverage in those areas. Coming up with a $1,500 Unify network was actually quite hard because it really depends on how you want to use it. But let's see what I came up with. For the $1,500 Unify network, I went with the Dream Machine SE. Now, this is a rack mount form factor, so you might want to have a rack, but you can also just get something that'll mount that on the wall, or you can, you know, put it on a shelf or something. The Dream Machine SE is going to be your Unify console. It has an option to add protect cameras if you want to add some surveillance to the network, and it has an 8-port switch, and some of those ports are PoE. For the access points, I went with 3 of the U6 Pros, right? So the Dream Machine SE does not have built-in Wi-Fi, so you're going to need 1 access point in that location, and then those 2 back hallways will get the other 2 access points. I also added in 1 of the U6 in-wall access points that I put out in the garage, because you remember in the $600 network, the garage didn't quite have the best coverage, so we're adding 1 supplemental access point out there. And finally, I am also adding in the Flex 10 gigabit switch. This is just to have some 10 gigabit connectivity in the network. For instance, if you had a computer that was capable of 10 gigabit or a network attached storage device or something like that. Again, this is me trying to actually spend all $1,500 and this is what I came up with. Your mileage may vary. And looking at the coverage of this network, here's all of the equipment, the 10 gig switch, the UDM SE, as well as the one of the U6 Pros down here. I got a U6 Pro up in this hallway, U6 Pro in this hallway, and then there is that in-wall out in the garage. And you can see the coverage here is actually quite nice. The whole house is bathed in Wi-Fi. Shouldn't have a problem getting a signal basically anywhere. And let me be totally clear about the $1,500 network. As I said previously, I was trying to spend $1,500 here. You can absolutely have perfect wireless for way cheaper by going with that $600 setup that I mentioned initially. You don't have to spend this kind of money to get solid Wi-Fi. All right, I want to hear from you guys. What would you do differently if you had a $600 or $1,500 budget to spend on your network? Let me know down in the comments below. And If you'd like to keep this party going, I have hand-selected a couple of videos on the right here for you to watch next. The top video is my recent overview of what's new in Unify 8.0.7, and the bottom video is my initial impressions of the new Unify Express device.